This is indeed a great hour. So now we have to study the hadith of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, because he said certain things. He laid them out very clear, and all we have to do is listen to his voice. So brothers and sisters, with that, our minister's here. We're happy to have him on this Wednesday night, and I hope your cup is wide open, okay? Because he's going to fill it until it overflows. Let's bring on Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the worlds, and in the name of his true servant and last messenger, our beloved leader, teacher, and guide, the messenger of Allah, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. Our brothers and sisters, once again, it is our privilege to be able to share with you some of that which we have learned from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. On this coming Friday, be it the will of Allah, scholars will be coming in from around the country to help us to expose more of the teachings and understanding of the message of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. If we were to have lectures Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday, or if we were to be on television, there are many things that we would like to say that we probably would not be able to say in the course of a lecture. However, when you have scholars of religion, scholars of philosophy, scholars of economics and political science, scholars who have devoted their life to the study of the family, and we allow these scholars and news people to question us on the teachings and program of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, it will help us to expose more of his message. It will be videotaped, and we will use it by the grace of Allah as resource material for the students of Islam under the guidance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad here and throughout the world. There will be eminent scholars coming who have made it their business to study the life of Malcolm X and to question us concerning Malcolm X and his relationship to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. There's much that we want to say about the lives of these two men and how their lives impact on our lives. The scholars of Islam and religion may want to question us on the Imam Warith Deen Muhammad and his profound effect on the nation of Islam. We will be more than happy to answer the scholars' questions. This will not be for the newspapers or necessarily for the press, but it will be for the edification of us and scholars who may desire at some point to study what we have to say. Of course, the world may be interested in those tapes, as they were in the case of the Nixon tapes or in the case of other men of consequence. They took their message and either turned it into a book or kept it for their memoirs. However, the object of all of this careful exposition of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is so that each of us may get out of Farrakhan what God has put in him at this time and try to get as much from the brother as we can as guidance to go through the next year or two, which will be difficult times for us as a people and for America as a nation and for the world. So we look forward to Friday. That will be, of course, in the afternoon. However, if it becomes so that we must go into the evening, then we may not have study on Friday, but we may just allow you to study from what we are saying and what the scholars are asking. Tonight, we want to talk on the family. In Islam, as in the teachings of Christ and in the teachings of Moses and all of the prophets, the family is a most important, or the most important unit of civilization. Unfortunately, most of us have grown up without family, without strong family units. As a result, we are not as psychologically, emotionally, or spiritually prepared for life as we should be. Proper family life prepares the children to go out and meet and overcome the obstacles that life presents. Proper family life fosters in the children those qualities of love and service that make us willing to step out from our families and use our gifts and talents for the betterment of community or for the betterment of a nation and a world. Therefore, family is given in the Bible and Quran a very high and sacred place. And this is why those things that interfere with family are punished with such severe punishment in the Holy Land or in the divine world. Family is sacred. That which breaks apart family is punished severely, because anything that destroys the family undermines the nation. So the strength of the family is really the strength of a nation. America is becoming ever weaker because there is a disease, social disease and spiritual disease, that is eroding and breaking up family life. The core of family is marriage, and the core of family is the relationship between a man and a woman. Now, the Holy Quran teaches us that Allah created us from a single essence. That tells us that male and female came from the same essence. That essence is the very nature of God Himself. Although male and female are different by nature, the essence of male and female is the same. But between these two, male and female, the Quran says that Allah put love and compassion. Now that's already there between male and female. It's already there. You don't have to create love. The love is already put there in the nature of us, but like all things, it must be nurtured. It must be developed. Okay? Now, when we say that love is put and compassion is put between the male and the female, does this mean that a man can take a woman that he does not love and grow in love with that woman? Yes. And vice versa, is that the same, that a woman can even say she wants to marry a man, but the love is not really powerful, it's just a strong feeling between the two? Can this flower and blossom into this great thing called love? Yes. Yes. Much of what we call love in the Western world is not love at all. But it is the basic attraction that there is between male and female because of our unalikeness, and that God intends for us to come together at some point in our development, and we usually find our way toward each other. But the circumstances under which we find our way toward each other, experimenting with ourselves and with each other, is oftentimes confused with love. We fall, quote unquote, in love with a person. We say, I love her, or I love him. But if there is true love present, there is a commitment to service. To service. A woman that loves a man serves a man. A man that loves a woman serves a woman. Not sexually serving, and then the service is over. But a continual service or fulfilling of need. Are we clear?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Now, since man and woman are created in need, then each of us has a duty to the other to help fulfill need. It is the carrying out of a duty that fosters the love. Now, I know this romantic thing in the Western Hemisphere is quite a thing in our lives. And all of us look at television. We spend an awful lot of time watching these soap operas, probably. And you see people fall in and out of love as often as they fall in and out of bed.
That's right.
And we say, oh, this is something here. Well, brother and sister, we are going to have to be much more careful about our use or misuse of language. We have to recognize that if you don't have an experience with a person, you have the potential for great love, but the love may not be there. It is only through the experience and the duty that we perform for each other that the love is strengthened. Now, love can never be taken for granted. It should never be taken for granted, any more than you can take your stomach for granted simply because you ate tonight. Tomorrow is another day entirely. And if you don't perform your duty by feeding your face, so that your face will feed your stomach, then you will surely die. And you understand that. So you continue to take care of business. Some of you do it too well. And you overdo it and hurt yourself.
Go ahead, go ahead.
But the point is that love, like the stomach, has to be fed. And the thing that feeds and nurtures love is duty. Not, I love you, baby. Yeah, that sounds real nice. Darling, I love you. You know, that's real nice. But the need of each individual to be satisfied, to be fulfilled, becomes the duty of the husband to the wife and the wife to the husband. And when we take care of our duty, which is binding upon us in a marriage. I mean, when you give your covenant that I will look after this woman, I will do thus and so and thus and so. And they say, do you say you're going to do this? And you quickly say, yeah, man, get it over with. You want to hurry on to the honeymoon. Yeah. But the honeymoon is over so quick. Because the duty fails. Because oft times you really are getting acquainted with each other. And it is only through living together that you get to know one another. But I'm not suggesting that we just say, hey, let's live together so we can get to know one another. You can live with any woman or any man and get to know them. But the Quran and the Bible want us, when we live together, to live together in a bond of matrimony where we have pledged ourselves to each other to perform a certain duty. No woman should give herself to a man without the pledge of that man to perform a certain duty by you. And that duty must be the maintaining of the female. And maintaining doesn't necessarily mean in the narrow sense going out getting a job. It means that too. But maintaining means that man is responsible for the general upkeep of the woman. I'm not talking just about giving her a dollar here and there.
Yes, sir.
And baby, get yourself a pair of shoes at the Salvation Army while you run down to Flag Brothers or Florsheim and buy you a brand new pair. You send her to get a pair for 15 cents or 25 cents and tell her how good she looks in them because you're spending your money on the girlfriend. Sure will break up the family. Now, brothers and sisters, in truth, you know, the upkeep of a woman is a very serious job. The upkeep of a woman is like the upkeep of a building. I don't care how nice a shape the building is in, you must continue to look after it, lest it will deteriorate. That's the way it is with love and marriage. Unless you continue to look after the woman, it will deteriorate. The love will deteriorate. The bond will deteriorate. There must be the constant looking after need. Now, this has a corresponding effort on the part of a woman. Men have needs. And those needs, though in this world they appear to be sexual, but that's just the tip of the iceberg. We both have needs that are very deep and significant. The Quran says of a woman that she is created by the God that we may find quiet of mind in her. That's very heavy. And in this world, brother, a man needs quiet of mind. Everything that would give a man quiet of mind, God put it in the woman. We go to the television. We go to the movies. We go to an entertainment center. And they call our television our console. You understand?
Yes, sir.
This is she right here. This is the creature that Allah made for consolation of a man. I mean, that's heavy, heavy, heavy. We don't have time to plumb its depth tonight, but just think of the word console. You know, whenever somebody is grieved, you try to console them. Is that right? You try to say the right word, the right touch. You do the right thing to console the person who is aggrieved at the loss of a loved one, etc. A woman has a very special gift of consolation for a man. You can see it oftentimes in the children, the girl children. Sometimes they, as adults, sisters, you know, we lost that altogether. And it takes an awful lot to get it back. But in the little children, if you watch your little girls, they have a special way that they handle their fathers. You ought to check it out sometime. And they didn't learn this. Mama didn't teach it because she's not doing it herself half the time. But the babies, I'm not putting anybody down, sisters. But the babies, they have it naturally. Their husband will be laying there. You see him, you know, with his hand in his chin, and he's worried about something on the job or something is disturbing him. And that little girl, she can sense that there's something wrong with daddy. And she'll go to her father. And if he's laying down, she'll put her little head on his chest and just pet him like. Just pat him. That's consolation. She'll even rub his head. I'm telling you now, these little children are something. The little girls, they will want to do little things for the father to make him comfortable. They'll run, get his slippers for him. They'll do little things, knock over something while they're doing it, mess up something. But their intention is so good till the fathers, if you watch them, they get so close to their little girl. And therein is a great danger. We'll talk about that in another subject. But, sisters, you have it in you by nature, but somewhere along the line, as you grow, you have bad experiences that kill your desire as a consoler for a man. And it's a fact, brothers. When our girls fall in love the first time, that's their spirit to give, to console, to be whatever he wants her to be for that which will console his mind. But then when he does not know how to handle that genuine feeling, he destroys it. By mistreating her,
And then the next person that comes along, he got it hard, brother. And sometimes she will never go back to that original beauty of her true nature. This is what makes Islam so marvelous, and the teachings of Christianity in the New Testament, if understood, wherein it says you must be born again. And the only way that things can go back the way God wants them to be is if after you've lived such a crazy life that you decide, hey, I'm destroying myself, my family. I'm really not the man that I want to be. I'm really not the woman that I want to be. And no college can give you this. You just have to recognize that it is God who gave you these natures from the beginning, and it is only a return to God in an intelligent manner. I'm not arguing that we shouldn't return to God, but we should return to God in an intelligent manner. I don't think a return to God in an emotionalism that causes us to run up and down aisles and throw ourselves into walls and fall down in the, you know, under the name of getting the Holy Ghost. I don't think that's an intelligent return to God. It is an expression of your anguish, it is true. But the most intelligent expression or way of return to God is your obedience to God's will. That is the highest intelligent way of return. Some people go through this emotional thing, and it may be all right, but it never will make you happy. It must be that you bow your will to the will of God and then display his intelligence. Reasoning with one another, then the family can pull tighter and tighter together, particularly the husband and the wife. Now, some of you have gotten married, and your marriage is just a few days old, and it is already being torn asunder. What's the problem? Well, I didn't expect what I'm getting. I mean, the man don't want to work, he don't have no money. But didn't you know that? What's the matter? Well, he takes his clothes off. He leaves them all around the place. And I got to pick up after him. He don't brush his teeth. I had a brother even complain that his wife wouldn't take a bath, you know. I mean, I felt terrible just hearing such a complaint.
Go ahead, brother. Go ahead.
But I heard it, not through the grapevine. I heard it from his mouth in her presence. Now, after I heard it, I knew what I was listening to. And he was bitterly complaining. I said, brother, how you treating me? And there it was. Man got so busy in his work, he didn't have time for her. And that's the way your marriage dies. I know, brother, my wife is just one unusual woman. So many sisters, you know, they see a man standing up behind a rostrum and they see people hooraying and hurrahing and they say, oh, he must be wonderful. And he is, but he may not be so wonderful for you. You know, when men have a dedication to a mission, That mission is foremost in their lives. No woman can compete with a man and his mission. To even attempt to do that is to break up the marriage. Because the mission of a man is what gives the man his sense of purpose and value. That does not come from a woman. It comes from God to the man and to the woman. We all have some reason why we're here. And once a man discovers his purpose for existence, then the woman must console him as he pursues that purpose, but not try to compete with him for his attention in that purpose. Now, there's another side to that, brothers. We have to recognize that even though we have found a mission, we have also married a woman. And she deserves some of our time and our attention. She deserves some quality time. Not rushing in, you know, the food on the table, good. Eat the food, jump up, and run out, leaving her there frustrated through the day. Some of us, we marry the sister, they're so pretty, while we're courting them, and then a baby comes, and then two babies come. How do you think she feels being home all day long with nobody to talk to on her level? She's talking to babies. And then you have an excuse when you come home, you're too busy to talk to her or too tired. See, this breaks up the home. Because after a while, she will sort of rebel. You'll notice it in the home not being kept. You'll notice it in the meals. Sure, we'll notice it in the meals, bro. You might even notice it in her, the way she feels about herself. She won't dress like she used to. She won't become pretty for you like she used to. She'll just mope around the house in your old shoes or some sneakers or something. Then you start having a problem. You see her dressing up to go other places. She ain't dressing up for you and me. Well, that means she's about tired of us, brother. She's looking for somebody else, maybe, that will respond to her need. And her need, brothers, is not always sexual. In fact, it's very little. Her need is for companionship. Her need is for someone to talk to her. And in the course of her relationship with the children and the problems of growing up a family, she runs into things that tears her down. And the man must be there like the painter when he sees the paint chipping off the wall. He must be there to build her up as she's struggling with the home. And the same goes for that man. When he's out there on this job working for white folks, working hard and getting very little or nothing to bring home, that man has several problems and he needs some consolation. When he hits the door, he needs consolation. I mean, can you imagine a man digging ditches? They usually give black folk terribly hard jobs. And they give us so little pay for what they work us to death for. And then on top of that, you got to hear insults from the foreman or the boss. And then Oftentimes you want to cuss him out, you want to whoop the man, you really want to kill him sometimes. But you think about them babies, and Lord, you won't be able to feed them, so you swallow all of that. Well, by the time you get home, you're ready to whoop something. Now, that's a shame that it has to be her. And sisters, you catch the brunt of all of the frustration of your husbands in this crazy, mixed-up world. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had a way for us to do it. First of all, he knows and he knew that our women have talents equal to ours, sometimes in some respects superior. But God holds the man responsible as the head of his family. Both the Bible and the Quran make man the head of his house. In order to be the head, you must have a head. You cannot be the head simply because biologically we are the male. We must be equipped with the knowledge with which to head up a home. You would not expect a person to lead without knowledge, would you? And you go to the leader, say, "Leader, such and such and so and so, what do you think?" "I don't know." "Well, leader, I want to do, what do you think?" "Well, I don't know nothing about that." Well, pretty soon you keep saying, "I don't know." That man recognizes that he is the leader talking to one that claims to be the leader. It's the same way our women feel. See, the thing that keeps your home together is not your good looks or your physical prowess, but it is the knowledge and how you use the knowledge to maintain your home and your wife and your children. And the proper use of knowledge makes women actually act like girls. Now, what did I say that for? Some sisters don't like that at all. Now, wait just a minute. I'm not putting you down. Just a minute. Do you know when a woman has a relationship with a man that is secure and she is secure, she acts like she did when she was very young in terms of lack of, not the burden. Her voice reflects youth. Her mannerisms are very girl-like. That doesn't mean to put you down. I'm saying, and if you haven't had that experience, you ain't been in love with a real man in a long time. In fact, maybe you've never had that experience. And I think it's a wonderful one for you to have, especially if you're 80. And let me tell you something. Now, wait a minute. When you are up in age, the right kind of relationship can make you youthful again. That's what I'm saying. And it is bad relationships that age you, mess you up, sister. You grow old before your time, and you actually think nobody cares about you, and then you just eat, get fat, and sit around getting nosy, looking into everybody's business. That's a miserable woman. And you don't have to be that way. I'm telling you, marriage in Islam should be a wonderful experience. And that doesn't mean it's not going to have its ups and downs. But I don't think any of you that get married should divorce within the first year. Or the second year. Or the third year. Take them 3 years to even find out what you're into. And if you can hang in there for 3 years, usually you can make it. But them first three, they're rough. Because that's when you're getting adjusted. And I know, brother, you think you can find better in some other woman. And I know, sister, you think you can find better in another man. Everybody looks good. Because you don't know them. But we are like pieces of wood cut out of the same pile. And whatever you find wrong in one, I bet you it's in the other. To one degree or another, we have similar problems. The idea in Islam is to help us to see that marriage is a struggle where a man and a woman with different natures, which means that you view things differently. A man and a woman can look at the same object, they won't see it the same way. And this means that a man has to listen to a woman. To look at it from her perspective. Your perspective is your perspective, but it is not the truth. It is absolutely necessary to listen to somebody else. Now, when you learn to really listen to a woman, she already has learned to listen to you. But a man has to learn to listen to a woman in order to really hear what she's saying. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, the problem with 90% of the marriages is improper communication between two people. You're not listening to each other. You're not listening to each other. You're not really serving each other's needs. Well, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, in my judgment, as a spiritual teacher, knew the great talents of women, but he also knew that women would never be happy unless you really have a strong, developed, intelligent man. And the man is so timid to go out front and exert himself till he pushes you out front. You don't mind, but you would be happier if he would go out and take the lead sometimes. So sometimes you even push him out. Sometimes you get so angry with him, you cuss him out to push him out. Right. Now, brothers, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad forced a black man to get out. Force you, man, to go out and face that world for your wife, for your children. Now, in the beginning, in truth, our women stayed home. The men went out and fought this enemy in the world, brought the money home for her to take care of the children. That's the way it was with me when I first became a Muslim and I got married. I didn't have any children at first. I never expected my wife to go out to work unless there was some absolute necessity. Now listen to this. My wife had more money sometime than me when we were growing up together. She would always want to buy me things. I refused. From a little boy now, I ain't but 15, 16, 17, I do not allow a woman to take care of me. My mother did that. I didn't marry a mother. You understand? This is my life companion. You're not my mama, so I don't call you, hey mama. I ain't got but one of those. And if you're not my mama, then I don't call, hey pretty mama. See, that's a little boy that's still looking for a mother. He don't really need a wife. He wants a mother to look after him, to take care of him. And this is what most of our marriages end up with, a mama. And that's why we use them nasty language, or that nasty language, sir, that we use. Sir. Because the woman has never been treated as an equal sharer in this partnership. She's been treated like she's our mother that has to help to nurture and develop us. Brothers and sisters, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad never liked that. He didn't like that in a man. He never liked no man that couldn't stand up and be a man. See, there really is no excuse, man, in truth. I know it's hard out there. But when you got a wife and you got children, don't talk about it's hard. Make a way. Because if you got the will, God will make a way. You will always be able to look after your wife and your children. Now, there was just something in me not to take nothing from a woman. Not that she can't buy me a gift, but I don't like a man that got money in his pocket and then spend his wife's money. That's not right, brother. Whatever a woman earns, she really helping you. Because it really is your duty, not hers. That's the fact. I found me a little place, and with my little money, I went and bought some wallpaper. Didn't know what I was doing, but I got up on the ladder. I had more paste on me than on the paper, but I was trying to work it out. People would come and look at us and say, them is bad people in bad shape. Well, it's all right. Two people can start off in bad shape, but they won't end up that way if they stay together and work as a team. You can do what you will, but you must stay together and fight to overcome the thing that would tear you asunder and destroy something that has the potential for tremendous beauty. We started having children right away. Worst thing you can do is live in your mother's house or your father's house. Get out of somebody's house. You don't have any marriage, brother, living with your mother. Your wife can't feel like a woman in your mother's kitchen. Mama always laying a meal on you. You know your wife just learning how to cook. And you stay in there with your mama. She's in there pouting, puffed up all the time. You wonder what's going on. Mama says, I baked you your favorite pie, dear.
That's the truth. Go ahead.
Oh, no, he doesn't like his rice that way, honey. He likes it like this. Man, get out of your mama's house. Go find you a place if it isn't but a room with just a bed in it and a little stove. Stay there till you can do better. But it's got to be hers. She's got to be in her own. She's got to feel the freedom to walk in her own and learn to please you and learn to cook the things that you want and learn how to do it. You understand? You can't have it successful in nobody else's house. Oh, that's my friend. I understand that. They might used to be your friend if you stay there long enough. Get in a place of your own, no matter how small it is, and grow from there. I went down to a secondhand place, found me a bedroom set. I would have loved the new one, but you see, I have never liked the way the Jews and others sell you things on time and then beat the hell out of you when you can't make the payment and threaten you. See, I'm a man. I don't want nobody coming to me threatening me about nothing. Understand, I'm an honorable man. I pay my bills if I got it, but don't threaten me. I had a nice car one day. I'd been paying on the car 2 years and then some and fell into some difficulty. You know what I mean? It happens. I got 3 months behind. Beautiful Seville. The man threatened me. He was going to come get it. I said, you come. I said, I bought me a gun. I said, you put your foot in my driveway, I'll blow your backside where I can't find you. And look here now. I'm serious. It's a heart attack, brother. I told him I'd throw gasoline and burn it up before I let you take the equity that I put in it. And I meant what I said, and I'd have killed him and burned the damn car, brother. See, when you work hard for something, you got to be enough man to protect what you've earned. Because anybody can understand if you pay your bills that you get into trouble sometime, but don't threaten me. I'm a man. I'm not taking it. That's when you bring war out of me. I ain't never like nobody telling me that I owe them. Some of you love to buy things on time. Oh, it's so nice, darling. Let's get it. And the big dummy, he goes sign. Because he want to make you happy. But when he can't pay the note, and they threaten to come take your happiness, then you're on his case. Look, brother, debt is slavery. I mean, you can't get through this life without some kind of debt, but debt is slavery. I always like to be free. Whatever's in my house, I want to own it. I don't want to have no white man writing me letters every month. And the reason you are messed up like this is because you try to live beyond your means. And when you live beyond your means, you live in mental stress. This is why some of you have strokes and you're 20 years old. This is why some of you got all this high blood pressure, because you don't know how you're going to make ends meet. I'm saying or suggesting that we all should live within our means. And there is nothing wrong with buying something secondhand until you can get it firsthand. Well, you don't look like you got on nothing secondhand. I can afford firsthand now. But I couldn't always. And when I couldn't, I didn't try to play like I could. I dressed in used suits. Didn't nobody know it but me and the person that sold it to me. And if you look real good, they never fit real proper. So you could tell, man, why don't that cat buy a suit that fit him? Shoulders all out here, you know what I mean? Tailor it so tight till the pockets meet in the back. But my mother used to tell me, if you don't have a horse, you ride a jackass. The object is to get where you're going. Brothers and sisters, it is money and the misuse of money that breaks up homes. You can't have a good marriage if you're arguing every 5 minutes over what to do with the money. Now, y'all got to sit down and talk this thing over. Especially if somebody wants to get you deep in debt And you say, well, sweetheart, let's take it easy a little bit. She may pout a while. You hold too, brother. Or he may pout a while, but you hold too, sister. Because debt will destroy your marriage, especially when you get into some little difficulty and you're not able to pay your bills. That's when you start getting insecure. And when you get insecure, I mean, he ain't got no peace, no way. A man cannot have a peaceful home if his wife feels insecure. All right? Just little rules. Just little rules, you know. It's difficult, brother and sister, to marry a woman that you can't do anything for. You meet a woman, she got a house. Her first husband died. Left her with a house. She's got babies. Got a car in the driveway. What can you do for her? If you don't have a whole lot of sense where you can upkeep her spiritually and mentally and psychologically and emotionally, you better leave her alone. You can't handle that. You know, Prophet Muhammad married a woman who was very rich, but he had some stuff up top here that compensated. She had everything else, but he had what she didn't have. And that was that wisdom that develops and builds up character. And she loved him. That woman was 15 years older than he was. But they got along well because he had something to offer that marriage. It isn't always the age. I would marry her, but she's so young. Well, now don't tell me she's 9. We have to talk to you about child abuse, brother. Child molestation, right?
Go ahead, brother. Go ahead.
She should be mature enough to make sound judgment. But there's no real crime if you marry a woman older than you. If it's all right with you, it should be all right with anybody else. But make sure, brothers and sisters, when you get ready to say that you want to marry, that you have explored all of the things as much as possible. See, what happens in marriages, you get too lost in sex till you never explore what you're dealing with until after you've said, I do. This is why in Islam, we do not permit sex before marriage. What? Let me out of this place tonight. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute now. Wait a minute. Sisters, free love never protects a woman. Never. I think it's hard on you the more you give in to your biology. It becomes harder for you. Because when men can get you as they want you, they never really want you. They go and get somebody that they feel is more moral. Very few men marry women that are knockabouts. Do you hear what I'm saying? They'll knockabout with you. But when the time comes to choose a mate, they don't choose the knockabout. They choose the one that they couldn't get to too easy. Because a moral woman really inspires the true admiration of a man. When a man knows that he's trying but can't get to first base, that makes it intriguing. You know what I mean?
Yes, sir.
That's some woman, man. I'm telling you. He tells his friend, man, she ain't like the rest. I mean, she's something special. And before you know it, he begins acting by you with honor and respect. You force him to be honorable to you by the way you handle yourself.
Yes, sir.
Free love hurts you, hurts the woman more than the man, because once you start engaging in free love, and when I say free love, I mean no commitment on the part of the man, then you come up pregnant. Well, naturally, when you tell him, watch his reaction. I just want to tell you that I'm in trouble. You sure are? He's not going to say to you, sweetheart, 9 out of 10 men will not say, darling, go ahead and have the baby. I'll work hard and we'll take care of it. You know, they say, hey, you don't know what to do?
Go ahead, brother. Go ahead.
Well, that costs money. Well, get it up.
Right.
And then he may threaten to whoop her.
That's right.
And you notice his attitude changes real quick when pregnancy comes in.
Yes, sir.
Check it out. Free love is a mess. And once you have the baby, if you don't want to abort it and you have it, then he cuts out. Because he didn't want a family anyway. He wanted pleasure. He didn't want a family. So now he's gone to mess up somebody else's daughter. And here you are with a child. Now look, sister, you deserve a man to help you raise your children. You deserve that. That little life coming on the planet deserves a father somewhere to look after its needs, as well as a mother. But when the man doesn't have any respect for you, just has a relationship with you and gives you a child, then runs off, you're stuck with a new life. Half the time, you love the baby, but you don't love the baby like you should. Because it's very difficult to love a child when you don't love the one that gave you the child.
Yes, sir.
That's right. Come on.
You got to struggle. I mean, you will do what you can for it. You know what I mean? But don't interfere with my life. Where you going? I'm going to the party. Well, what about your baby? Later. See, you don't want to give up for your new life. Because you're not satisfied. I mean, it's a sad set of circumstances. Free love is not good. I know, man. We're all under the biological temptation to experiment. But I think if God blesses us to learn how to eat to live and learn how to fast and learn how to discipline ourselves, we would be much better off if we can discipline ourselves to abstain until God enriches us out of his grace with a man that will honor and respect you. Now, I'm going to close. The most important part of any marriage is not the marriage itself, but it is the approach to the marriage. The courting experience is one in Islam where a man and a woman must determine whether or not we are suited for marriage. In Islam, you don't say sue for breach of contract or breach of promise. You can't do that in Islam. Because as long as a man has nothing to do with you sexually, then you are not obligated to him and he's not obligated to you. During that courting period, that's the time when the man and the woman must be as open and honest to find out all you can about that individual. You'll never find it all out, but you will at least know enough to know whether you're making the right decision. When you go to court, The object of court is to display the evidence upon which a judge will make a decision. This is why you are called, when two people are in love, they say they are courting. That's what it means. They are deciding based upon the evidence whether there's sufficient evidence there to justify making that big step. And that's a serious part of any relationship between a man and a woman, whether the woman or the man is really worthy. And sometimes, you know, we get so scared because we feel, oh, I got a man that likes me and I don't want to let him go. Somebody else will get him. And yes, been so long, you know, and but something tell me the man ain't right, you know what I mean? You better let that fella go. You know, Nat King Cole said, it's better to be by yourself. If you're with somebody that is actually going to take you to hell with them, it's better to be by yourself. Don't ever be afraid to give up something that is worthy of being given up. Because there's always something better for you somewhere if you're patient enough to wait. I wonder, do you believe that? Okay. So we'll close by saying to the sisters and to the brothers, you know, the success of our marriages is the success of the nation. We must not have high divorce rate in Islam. God hates divorce. He permits it, but he hates it because you could have made it if you only got past the hump. You run out on each other too soon. Stop it. Fight it out. I don't say fight it out this way. I mean struggle with it. Those of us who will not struggle with one another in marriage, how will we struggle with one another for the sake of the unity of us as a people? Yes, sir. Now, you just came in this mosque, you meet women, and we meet men, brothers and sisters, that you never knew before. Now, how are you going to have a relationship with each other that is sisterly? Well, I don't like that sister. I don't, that brother makes me sick. But now you're in a brotherhood together. What are you going to do? You can't deny a brother that God has chosen for you. You have to work with him. You have to work with a sister. Now, if you don't want to work with each other, you're impatient. You walk away from one another, condemn each other. See, that's a sign to me that in your own life, you walk away from your husband, walk away from your wife when things don't go well, because you walk away from each other when things don't go exactly as you think they should go later for you. That's not the approach. We're going to have to struggle to find unity as a people. And the struggle is with ourselves and with each other. So must we struggle to find unity as a husband and a wife. Those who do not wish to struggle will not find the joy of true union when it takes place. When a man and a woman have achieved that kind of union, it's one of the most beautiful things to behold. Because the two become actually one. They begin to look alike. You listen to them, they sound alike. This is true. They grow right in to each other. Yeah? One of them can be away from the other and feel the other. Sense what's going on with their mates. I mean, that's powerful. It can grow just like that. And you never worry about growing old. Because as the woman grows older, she may lose the form that she had as a teenager, but she grows into another kind of beauty that a teenager could never give you. Did you hear what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. The older she gets, she grows into another kind of beauty that needs to be appreciated. And let me tell you something. Most men that have a woman that's by their side for years, and they give that woman up for a young, pretty child. You watch them after a while, see how miserable they are. Now, the young girl was sure enough pretty. And she may sure enough be fine. But you see, to console that mind, takes more than a pretty face and a fine shape. Takes a woman who has grown to know that man. Growing older together is a wonderful thing. You ought to try it. I think you'll love it. May Allah bless you. Thank you for listening. Assalamu alaikum. I see a brother in the back, a brother over here. Where's the third? No sister? Oh, I see three. All right. I saw a brother over here somewhere first. Where's the brother that raised it? Where? It was not related to the subject matter. Okay, we'll hold that one then. Yes, brother.
Yes, sir. You're from the Holy Quran. Brothers allowed to have four wives. Is that in the Holy Land, or can that be done in the United States as well?
Very good question. Question, I will repeat the question. You may be seated. In the Quran, it says a brother may have as many as four wives. Is that for the Holy Land, or can that happen in the United States of America? And when you say four wives, immediately women, black women in America, get totally upset. I don't have to say any more, right? Wait a minute now, sisters. That brother asked a very good question.
Yes, sir.
And I think we have an obligation to answer it properly. I'm going to answer it very quickly. Polygamy in Islam is not the rule. Polygamy in Islam is the exception. Now, my brother, when we understand why polygamy was introduced, then we understand the Quran's teachings. Allah says in the Quran that one is better for you if you but knew. One is better for you if you but knew. Again, it tells you if you have more than one wife, you are to treat all of them with justice, and it says, and you cannot. There'll always be one that you favor over the other, and once you do that, you set up hell in that house. One is better for you if you but knew. Now look, however, now there is a however. There is a however. I want you to listen to this. During the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the men in Islam were forced to fight because the forces against Islam were so that they were bent upon the destruction of Islam. So after several wars, many of the males in the ranks of the Muslims were decimated. Their ranks were decimated. You had women with children who were like widowers. You had a preponderance of females, a shortage of males. Now you have a social condition that could lead to two things, because all of us have a biological need. Those social conditions, when you have a preponderance of women and a small population of men, there's not enough men for the women. This puts the women in severe competition with each other for the men. And it leads to prostitution and homosexual behavior. Prostitution is a scourge on society, and homosexuality is that which is abominable in the sight of Almighty God and led to the destruction of the civilization called Sodom and Gomorrah, and America is headed in that same path today. Now the question is, which one of the evils, and polygamy is an evil, which one does Allah tolerate as a means of balancing the society? He will never tolerate prostitution, and he will never tolerate homosexual behavior, so he tolerated polygamy to bring balance back to that society. Now, here's the way polygamy was carried out. First of all, you have in the society women with children and no man. If the male had economic means, then out of his love for his brother, whose life was lost for the cause, he marries the wife of his brother and looks after the children of his brother, giving the woman a husband and the children a father. Now, when you talk about polygamy in these terms, see, people don't want that because they want to go out and get the foxes and have a harem full of young ladies. You understand what I mean? That's not the way that's supposed to go. Now, if it's, you understand what I'm talking about. You're trying to give balance to a society that has lost its balance. Any way you do it is hard. Because the woman who wants to be the exclusive object of her husband's love, she now has to share him. Well, most of you are sharing him anyway, but you don't know it, probably. Wait, did I say something wrong? Oh, God forbid. Now, just this, I don't know what's going on. But seriously, though, there may come a time, sisters, and as you can see it now, women outnumber men. Our men are filling the jails, the insane asylums, and the armed forces because they have no job. So the army takes them away. Jails take them away. Drugs take them away. And here you are left, a woman with needs and not enough men. And then homosexuality coming up among our men so strong now. And this is why when you hear me speak against the image of Michael Jackson, or the image of, what's that other fellow? Oh, hell with Boy George, I mean. Yeah, Prince or some of these other. I'm not concerned about Boy George and white folks. You could have Boy Georges on every corner, and white folks won't be affected that bad because there's enough strong male images for white boys. We do not have strong male images for us. Every time we get a strong black leader, that leader is snuffed out. On the scene today, our people that are being pushed on the black public are those in music and those in sports, and mainly the musicians, and there's a tendency toward freakishness. You understand? So when a man don't want a woman, he wants another man. I don't care how pretty he looks. You understand? It should be an abomination to you who don't have enough men as it is when you see a man and he's acting like another woman.
You ought to be repulsed by that. Because every time they do that, they may take another young boy and make him into a little faggot. And before you know it, no, I'm serious, man. I'm serious. We get turned on by people in positions of influence. And when our little boys can walk around with sequin gloves and curls running down their hair and talking soft and sweet. See, you're making a reason for polygamy. And before this is over, there will be bloodshed. We are not going to gain freedom without bloodshed. And some of us are going to pay that price. And I'm hoping that if I'm killed, leaving my wife and my children, that some brother of mine will say, I love Brother Farrakhan, and he left a wife and children. Let me look after his wife and his children. That shows your love for me. And if something like that happens to you, we show our love for you by taking up the responsibility of your wife and your children. And then sisters show their love for each other by recognizing that this has to be in order for the society to come back to balance. And when it is back to balance, we go back to what is best. And what is best is one woman for one man. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Coming to their schools, and he wanted to make friends with the European. Why is it that they
rejected? Why is it that the Europeans rejected? Her question is, she read about the Moors. Moors are black people who were under Islam from the 7th century to the 11th century they ruled. And these black brothers and sisters of Africa, who were Muslims, went up into Europe, civilizing the Europeans. Now, the Europeans adopted a lot of the culture and civilization of the Moors, but they never accepted Islam. Islam is a strict teaching of righteousness, and white folk don't have it in their nature to live strict, upright to righteousness. And this is why the Honorable Elijah Muhammad referred to them as devils. It is because they love the doing of evil more than they love the doing of good. And if you ever want to upset white people, just ask them to live a righteous life. Now, there are some on this earth that are trying to live a righteous life, white people, and God will bless these that are trying to live righteously. But Islam has never been successful in Europe among the Caucasians. It has been successful among all the peoples of the earth except white people. They don't want to live right and do right by themselves or anyone else. And if they don't do right, as you might have seen what I said on television last night, I'm surprised that they put it on there, but they did. I said the white man's rule is an unjust rule. I said, and if you do not accept the truth and live according to that truth, you will surely die. And I said to them, you are already dead in the wickedness or sins of Adam, but you will die physically in a flaming fire of hell. And they put that on television. But that's as clear a warning as a man could give, that God is not playing with these white folks or with us. We're going to have to get out of their wicked way. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, as I close this point, says, once you know who the white people are, you can't fault them for being what nature made them, but you must fault yourself for following them in evil. After you know them and know yourself, you should never let white people be a guide for you into good conduct. They are not good people. They are not the people to be your guides. They have been evil guides for us for 400 years, and now God does not want them to guide us or anyone else. He's taken them out of the position of power. Thank God for that. Yes, sir.
Minister Louis
Farrakhan.
Okay, I seen you on Sunday night on one of Sundays, and I just want to comment that you did a good job. It's my first time here, and I came here because I heard you was here. There may be some brothers and sisters seeing me out there.
Right.
But okay. I want to tell you that you did a good job, a beautiful job, and I want to thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. I just want to say thank you. You know, brother, the enemy does so much evil against us. And then we have a brother in television who would come and ask you certain questions and then put it on television. And here's a brother that just saw it on television. And as a result of what he saw, he came out to hear some more of what he heard. Now that proves that no matter what they do against us, it is actually for us. And we have to learn how to use this instrument that this white man has to get to our people. Thank you very much, brother. Every time the doors open, you're welcome here. This is your home. Thank you. Wa alaikum salam.
Brother Farrakhan, okay, now the women are, okay, we're physically and sexually forced, okay? And then they physically beat us, okay? And then if we can't move to the other side of town, there's no way that we can really get away from this man. And we're not crazy. What we do is go to another man to get this man off of us. But we really tired of doing that. But what else could we do? What can we do? You know what I'm saying?
If I understand you. If I understand what you're saying. You're telling me you between a rock and a hard place. You got one man that's whooping you, and you want to get away from him, so you go to another man for protection from that man who's whipping you. And the man that you go to for protection, he's about the brother of the man that's whooping you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But we don't know how to get out of the situation.
Come on here. I don't think they're that crazy. They're not gonna run up in here and bother you. Once you accept to be yourself, sister, we will give our lives to protect you. So you made the right decision. And I see your beauty just returning, you know, and coming out of you more and more every time I see you. And I thank Allah. You just keep on sticking with the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You never have to worry about a decent man. You won't have to worry about no man chasing you and beating on you. But we just won't tolerate that. I don't think he could take what we would put on him.
That you had this ministry right here, I've sat at home and I recorded your tapes on Sunday. And I started coming out on Sundays because you wouldn't give me but
1 hour. Consequently, when I play your tapes and the things you have to say and the message that you have, brothers and sisters, for my company, my guests, people might come back after the big old box of them sitting on the back. Man, what you got here? Hey, man, ain't no rock and roll in that. All that's brother and that's a fresh. But like I say, you don't give me but an hour. Nah, they sitting there just like I'm sitting there. We want to know the rest. What else? I give up taping you, and now you don't sit there.
Thank you. My brother, I wanted to say, while you were talking, I was saying that about you. In my mind, I was saying that as you were speaking, I was just looking at you and seeing the beauty of our people. All we need is truth and somebody that cares. And as we begin to manifest our beauty, I was thinking how easy it is. How easy it is to give your life for your people when you love them. And I thank you for what you said, and I pray that Almighty God, Allah, will make me worthy of your love and the love of the brothers and sisters. But I am so pleased that He has fashioned me in a way where I am willing to give my life.
Yes,
sir. I used to say that before, but now it's become easy not just to say it, but to do it. You are a wonderful people, and soon you will come into your greatness.
Yes, sir.
And when you look at each other, you will fall in love with each other, because of the beauty of who and what you really are.
Yes,
that white folks would never tell you.
Yes,
but you are learning how great you are as a people.
Yes,
your future is great. I would just urge you, as I close this meeting, to look after yourselves and each other. Don't be so quick to do harm to yourself and to one another.
Yes, sir.
Eat the best foods. Don't eat junk food.
Yes, sir.
Eat foods that preserve your life. And then fill this wonderful brain of yours with wisdom.
Yes,
because you are much more powerful than you think. I'm talking about this little young man right here.
Yes, sir.
And this young man right here.
Yes, sir.
And that's right, all of us. See, we don't think that we're much.
Yes, sir.
But brother, you're powerful.
Yes, sir.
You just have to get the knowledge. That's all you need. All the rest is there, ready to explode.
Right.
You keep on coming, brother, and bring your friends. Soon we won't be able to fit in here. It's getting to be that way. And I knew it was coming. We're not going nowhere. We just won't be able to fit in here. So by that time, by the grace of God, you can go home. And just turn on your television, and I'll be there talking to you. Every week, all over the country, black people coming up. And all over the world, you're going to see people like yourself rising up with the knowledge of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, as we have them now in Africa, jumping up. Right. Never have seen the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, but they got study groups going on in West Africa right now, studying the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So, I know that this, yes, 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 Lord. I know if I don't hear you, I'm going to feel bad. I should hear brother who raised his hand first, and then I will hear sister, and I will close out with this brother right here, okay? And we'll talk, brother, another time, all right? Because we can't stay here all night. You have things to do, and so do we. Yes, brother. Wa alaikum salam.
I've heard you say several times that you're welcome into Baptist churches because you're not trying to convert the congregation into Islam. I'm pretty sure it's in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's book, Message to the Black Man, where he says that on Judgment Day, those who come with a religion other than Islam will not be accepted.
That's true. Of course. The Holy Quran teaches that if you come up with a religion other than Islam, Allah will not accept it from you. Is that right? Then you read in the Quran, those who are Jews and those who are Sabaeans, those who believe in Allah and the last day, they have their reward. Now, how do you harmonize that by saying that when I go to a church, I don't try to convert those people to Islam? Then am I then aiding them in destruction if on the judgment, if they come up with a religion other than Islam? No. It's really great when you understand. See, everything that I'm doing, if you study, not just look at the man, but look at the method. Yes, sir. There's a technique that I am using to further the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Now, have you heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad saying that all black people are Muslims by nature? You heard him say that? You read it. Okay, you read it. Now, if all of us are Muslim by nature, then you can't convert anybody. To Islam, the lesson, the Savior never said convert the people. He said his greatest teaching was accept your own and be yourself. Right. What is yourself? A righteous Muslim. Okay. Now, when I go to church, and I talk to Christian people, who have the word of a man called Jesus. Do we recognize Jesus?
Yes, sir.
We do.
Yes, sir.
Every Muslim recognizes Jesus. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Then we recognize Jesus' revelation called the Injil, or the good news. So when I go to church, I know that the truth that Jesus taught is there. They may be confused, but it's there. And I also know that the nature of the people is righteousness. And I also know, listen to me carefully now, that when you talk about converting people, you frighten them.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Now, a person has been Baptist all their life. How do you tell a Baptist that's been a Baptist 60 years, come on over, I'm going to make you a Muslim? Now, just listen to what I'm saying. They say, Muslim? What is that? Then they begin to see Muslim as, oh, I got to change my dress.
Yes, sir.
Or they see Muslim as, I got to wear a headpiece, or I got to do this, or I got to do that. And they make the jump. Okay, I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it. And they leap from the church over to the mosque and never quite make it. They're neither this nor that. They're somewhere in between, lost, never have made it. And believe me, brother, Imam Wahid Din Muhammad proved that many who claim to be Muslims had not quite made it yet. So here's the way I approach it. And I'm telling you straight up, I'm a scientist.
Yes, sir.
I'm a scientist. What I mean by a scientist is I look for the best method to get the message over to our people and make them comfortable while you are giving them a message. Once you make people afraid, once you make them think, oh my God, I got to change out of this in order to be that, in order for God to accept me, then you set up all kind of psychological trauma in that person's mind.
Yes.
I want you to know you're already accepted by God. He has already chosen you to be his people in the church, in the prostitution house.
Yes, sir.
You still the people of God. You messed up, but he chose you. Now, how do I get you out?
Yes, sir.
Well, if I took you out of the church, where am I going to put you?
Yes,
we ain't got enough room here for everybody that's in the church.
Yes,
so the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said the truth would be taught where?
In the church.
So I go right to the church where the people are Christians, where they believe in Jesus and the scripture that he brought, and then I give them the truth of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad coming in the NGO through Jesus, through their belief as a Christian, and all of a sudden the church is on fire. Now, I haven't told them you gotta be what I am because they're already what I am.
That's right. Go ahead.
So why plague their mind with that?
Go ahead.
I just keep on feeding the nature of them, which is righteousness. And before you know it, what happens in the church is the old rituals that they begin to grow up out of, they leave it off. Little by little, you see them growing right up in the church. And before you know it, the brother and sister in the church, they'll be with the music, but then somebody will say, we don't eat pork.
Yes.
I was in a church a couple of Wednesdays ago, and I started talking about the Immaculate Conception and what it meant, and the Reverend jumped up and said, go ahead, because that's what he teaches his congregation. The truth is already there.
Yes, sir.
All you got to do is keep feeding the people.
Yes, sir.
And the people will grow into obedience to God. And what is Islam? Obedience to the will of God. So nothing will be accepted on that day but obedience to the will of God. You may call it Islam. They may call it Christianity. Somebody else may call it Judaism. But if it's obedience to God's will, you're going to make it. Thank you, brother. Now, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, I'm not being unfaithful to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the least. And this is why people who don't understand Farrakhan and how I suffer, because I want to see the people made like the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wants them made, but I know if you don't make them right, you mess them up. So I study how to do it, and I suffered to learn the method. And now, by the grace of God, I am successful. I got a call the other day from a very highly respected preacher. He said, brother, I just want to tell you I love you. I just want to tell you that we're praying for you. Not I'm praying, we. My congregation, we're praying for you. He's a big preacher. In Chicago. How did he pray for the Muslim? Because he see me the same as himself. And I see him the same as myself, because I'm not preaching to make distinctions. I'm preaching to bring people together. It's beautiful. And that's why white folks say, well, he ain't got but 5 or 10,000 followers. But yet they couldn't get no black person to speak out against me. That's what blew their mind. You don't know how many is out there that's with me. And that's what got them shook. They think the Muslims is going to jump up when they jump on me. And I heard a brother in New York say, don't you think that the only security that the minister got is these brothers out here with these bow ties on? He said, if you want to see some security, you all jump on him and you see where we come from. And I think that's the only way to talk to our people today, not make them uncomfortable with where they are. Take them as you find them. Teach them as you find them. Don't try to make them think that there's something wrong with them to make them think that there's something so right with you. And I feel that every one of you that I've been blessed to share knowledge with, if I meet you in the church next week and you are happy there, stay there. Just come get the knowledge and go back. Come get the knowledge and go back. Share it with your brothers and sisters. You don't feel comfortable wearing a long dress? Wear what you got on. That's all right. Just come get the knowledge, take the knowledge, and use the knowledge. As time goes on, you get it together. I mean, look, it ain't no big thing. No big thing now. Just be comfortable, brothers and sisters. You ain't got to strain. And you can't get these young men to join church where the preacher's acting the fool and dancing and cutting up. And these young people saying, man, I ain't for that. See, they're not for that. But these young men, all they want to know is where the strength is. They get the strength and they're coming up to take care of business. Young women the same. After a while, the church is going to be just like that. It'll be the church of Christ, and it's going to be a very militant church. The men in the church are going to be strong, brother. They ain't going to be that old broken wrist stuff. All them cats with the broken wrist, they get him behind the door here. And when you see him the next time, his wrist will be in a sling. When they come out that cast, it'd be straight from now. No, man, we want men. And I'm not saying anything against you if you have homosexual tendencies, brother and sister. Look, it's all right. What you're doing is wrong, but you're the one that God is after. And if we wouldn't put a junkie down or put a brother down that's committed murder, come out of prison, why should we put a homosexual down? That's not what it's all about. It's all about telling people what God expects of us, then watch them change and feed them the truth that will make them change without somebody forcing them to change. That's right. And every one of you are righteous. I'm telling you, I don't care what you're doing. You are the righteous. All you need is somebody to feed your nature, and little by little, you will grow up to overcome every habit that you have that you are ashamed of right now. Yes, sir. So just don't worry about it. Just keep moving. It's terrible to preach to people and they're guilty. Oh, their minds all shook up with guilt. Oh, I smoked a cigarette. Oh. Please. You didn't hurt nobody but yourself. So you smoked a cigarette. Now you're supposed to be clean, so you snuck a cigarette. But what you gonna do? Oh man, I just feel so guilty. Well look, you just a little weak. Now learn how to put it down. Strengthen your will, don't beat yourself to death. Come on up out of it. But I didn't smoke a cigarette. I smoked the reefer.
That's right.
It's the same principle. It's the same principle. Look, the things that are not good for you, you and I need to develop the strength to put them aside. You can't put them aside without the strength to put them aside.
The strength doesn't come from running out of the temple. The strength comes from hearing the truth that strengthens your will to resist the thing that you know is harmful to yourself. And after a while, you will get so strong, brother, that a man can come in your midst with a pound of coke.
Yes, sir.
Put that coke down and say, have some. And you tell him, look, I don't deal. I just don't deal with that no more. And when you get that kind of strength, people will look at you as though you're crazy.
That's right.
But I mean, you could put 10 pounds, 100 pounds, 1,000 pounds around me. I would sit on it. I will never use it by the grace of God. And I would never, even though it's billions of dollars there, I wouldn't sell 1 ounce. Not to you, not to anybody.
Yes.
I love for you what I love for myself. And it ain't worth all that money to see your life messed up. It ain't worth nothing to me. See, I don't put no value on coke. My value is on you and your life and your children and the future of us as a people. That's what we must learn to value. Value yourself, value your people, value truth. I give my life for that. Value liberation. Don't value coke and a cigarette. Silliness. So you get the strength to put it down. And if you're not strong enough yet, you keep coming. You get the strength. And don't worry about it. If you're doing it, don't worry about it. We're not doing it. Hang out with us. We'll help you get strong. You can't hang out with weak people if you want to get strong. If you want to get strength against some bad habit that you got, go find people that are not doing that and hang out with them, and pretty soon you'll get the strength to put down the bad habit. Okay? May God bless you. Sister, way in the back. Yeah, I did see your hand. Yes, sister. Walaikum salam.
I just have to know, is the proper age for young sisters and brothers to consider marriage?
What is the proper what?
Age.
Yes. Well, there are some sisters who can consider it younger than others because they are mature. I don't think you should consider it too young. Some people that are 18 should consider it. Some that are 40 should not. Not the age, it's what you need for your life at that time. And I think that while it's nice for young people to get married, you need to know a little bit more about yourself and about life. Don't just run off into marriage because of a biological need and you see a nice young brother and he says, sister, let's get married. You know, I don't think that's the best way to go. You know, I think you need to just discover yourself a little bit. And as you learn more about yourself, you will never have to ask the question, because the right age will be the right age. You're ready to make the move. And when you're ready to make that move, it must be the right age, if you're truly ready. I don't come up to me saying you're 14 and you're ready to make that move. Grow in knowledge. And when you grow in knowledge, you grow in the strength and maturity to make you able to make that decision whenever that time comes. Okay? That's it. All right.
Thank you, sir.
I forgot you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to express my love for you and my mother's love and those who I have converted, so to speak, over to you, who have. Your image has been distorted through the media, and people have called you racist and some everything else. And I said, you don't know the man.
That's right.
I responded to that on Sunday morning live, and I think the brother had said he was just overjoyed when he heard some of the people calling in, and I just so happened to be one of those people that say they do not know the man. They have not come down here. They passed judgment on you and have not even seen you, heard you, only what the media, only certain things that the media has portrayed of you. And one other thing, I followed you around quite a bit, and you must see the array of photos that I have of you and some of the things you're doing.
Thank you. You all have certainly made this an enjoyable evening for me. Where?
Brother, I stopped before with the gray leather jacket.
Yes, sir.
All right, praise it through to
you. Oh, very good. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. This will be the last one now. Sister begged me. She said, just one, just one. Yes, sir. Walaikum salam.
Ms. Farrakhan, I wanted to ask you, in marriage, do you marry?
No, I have not done that. I can, but I have not done it in a long, long time. And the reason I don't marry, honest to goodness, I get tired of asking people to say vows and then 6 months later I turn around and they are, you know, it's so nice for them to have Brother Farrakhan marry them, because they think it's great honor, I guess, and privilege Minister Farrakhan married us. But it doesn't make me feel good. If I ask you to say certain vows and ask you beforehand, is this what you really want? And you tell me yes, and then a few months later I hear that you all are divorcing each other, it hurts. And so I think I've said about 3 or 4 marriages in about the last 7 or 8 years, and I think 3 of them ended up in divorce. I said, I'd rather bury it, because I know you ain't lying then. But if any of you would like me to marry you, I will consider it. Okay, may Allah bless you all. I thank you so much for making a beautiful evening. Thank you. Good night, buddy.